Hello students, in this video of ours we are going to learn about the microorganisms. Now what do you mean by micro? Micro means very small, very small organism which we cannot see with our naked eyes. Some of them we can see also, because bread mold you can see with your naked eye, but most of these organisms we are not able to see them with our naked eyes, because they are very, very tiny. They are very tiny, and so we cannot see them. But at the same time, they are playing a very important role in our lives. They are very, very useful to us, and at the same time, they are harmful to us as well. So in this chapter, we are going to learn about groups in which we can divide the microorganisms, their uses and their harmful effects on us and on other organisms. So let's start the chapter. Microorganisms, friends and foe. This is the name of your chapter. Microorganisms are our friends as well as foe. Foe means enemy. So they are having useful as well as harmful effects on us. So in this chapter we are going to learn about the uses and the harmful effects which the microorganisms are. Microorganisms are present all around us, but they are too small to be seen with naked eye. Because they are very small, that's why they are called microorganisms. Now, these microorganisms are present all around us, but still we cannot see them with our naked eyes. If your hands are dirty, your hands are full of microorganisms. If inside your rooms, around your plants, around you, inside you, even in your body, there are microorganisms present. So they are present everywhere, but we are not able to see them, because they are very small. They are present everywhere in the atmosphere. You can find them in air, you can find them in water, you can find them in soil, around us, outside us, inside us. They are present everywhere. Now these microorganisms, they are also called microbes. They are very small organisms which cannot be seen with an unaided eye. Unaided eye means the need, some aid is required by the eye to observe them. That means we require a magnifying glass or we require a microscope to see them. So they can only be seen with the help of the microscope. Microorganisms, they can be unicellular or multicellular. That means their body can be made up of one cell, like amoeba, paramecium, bacteria. They are made up of one cell only. Or their body can be multicellular. For example, many fungus are multicellular. So they can be multicellular as well. Microorganisms may occur alone. They may live a sedentary, they may live a solitary life. They are alone, for example, amoeba. And they may live in colonies as well, for example, algae. So they are living in colonies as well as alone. For example, you might have observed that during the rainy season, moist bread, this you all must have observed in your home, because you keep bread and in home sometime or the other it get spoiled by the fungus. You can see the green threads on your bread loaf and bread slices, and that is the bread mold, which is a fungus and which gives the white greenish patches on your bread slice. So that is a fungus. This you can see without the help of the microscope also. You can see it if you want to see the mycelium. The patches you can see with your eyes, unaided eyes as well. But if you want to see the mycelium, the thread-like structures and the fruiting bodies, then you require a magnifying glass to see them. Now, what are the different types of microorganisms? There are four main types of groups in which we can divide these microorganisms. And these four groups are bacteria, fungi, algae, and protozoans. Bacterias are prokaryotic, unicellular organisms. And this example for bacteria is Lactobacillus, the curd bacteria, E. coli, and there are many other bacteria as well. Algae, if you take the example, is Chlamydomonas, Spirogyra. Fungus, the bread mold, Penicillium, Aspergillus, then protozoa, amoeba, paramecium. These are the examples of protozoa. Viruses are also microorganisms because we cannot see them with unaided eye, but we cannot see them with our naked eye, but they are not being kept into the microorganism groups because they are different from other microorganisms in a way, because they are a link between living and non-living. The virus cannot survive outside for a long period of time. Virus requires a host, a body, where an organism where it will survive, it will reproduce, it will multiply, and it will survive inside the host body. Whereas the virus cannot survive outside for long. That's why the viruses are also microorganisms, but they are not being kept into the groups. They in these four groups, the viruses are not being included. Viruses are kept separate because they are different from the other microorganisms. They need a host. The host may be human body, plant body, any other animal body, any bacteria, but they require somebody to stay within. And they can grow, they can multiply only within the host organism. So this is the difference between viruses and other microorganisms. The common ailments like cold, influenza, and most coughs, they are caused by the viruses. Some serious diseases like polio and chickenpox are also caused by viruses. And nowadays, the corona, COVID-19 is there, and that is also caused by a virus. Now, see the diagrams of the bacteria. This is the bacteria can be divided into different types as per their shapes. Their shapes can be circular, cocci. Their shape can be rod shaped. Their shape can be spiral. Their shape can be comma shaped. So these are the different. This is the spiral bacteria. This is the rod shaped bacteria. They are very tiny organisms. And as per their shape, they can be divided into different types. Then if you want to see the algae, this is the Chlamydomonas and Spirogyra. These are the types of algae. Then in protozoa, the amoeba, paramecium, these are the protozoas. And if you want to see the fungus, then this is the bread mold, Penicillium, Aspergillus. These are the examples of fungus. So bacteria, algae, protozoa, and fungus. These are the four groups of microorganisms. Now virus. Virus, if you see the structure of the virus, it is a very simple structure. It has genetic material. It can be RNA or DNA. But most of the viruses, they are having RNA as their genetic material, and which is surrounded by a protein coat, and this protein coat is called capsid. So this protein coat is there, and these protein coats may have some spikes as well, and inside you will find the genetic material. So this is the structure of the virus. First we will see that how they are friend to us. What are the useful effects of these microorganisms on us? Microorganisms play an important role in our lives. Some of them are beneficial in many ways, whereas some others are harmful and they cause diseases as well. Microorganisms, we cannot think our life, our survival without microorganisms. They play a vital role in our survival because the most important thing what they are doing for us is they are cleaning our environment. They are converting the dead and decayed, decomposed material into the organic material, into the inorganic material, which can be reused by the plants and animals. And they are at the same time cleaning up the environment. Without microorganisms, this world, this earth cannot be a place for survival, because it will start stinking with the organic dead and decayed material. So the cleaning process, the cleaning job is done by these microorganisms, because they are decomposers. So organisms and the other uses are, they are making curd from the milk. So the milk, you must have seen your mother to put a teaspoon of curd into the milk. She will mix it and keep it. And after some time, after a few hours, you will see that the curd has been set. And that is because of the bacteria Lactobacillus. So Lactobacillus is the bacterium which is there in the inoculum, in that 1 teaspoon of curd which your mother is putting in the milk. And that bacteria will reproduce, because it reproduces so fast that in few hours it will be full, the whole milk will be full of Lactobacillus bacteria, and that milk will turn into curd. So the setting of curd, and this curd is more nutritious than milk. So we should be including curd in our meals on regular basis. Then making bread. This Lactobacillus is very friendly to us. It helps in the digestion, and it is nutritive. It has the nutritive value as well. Now, the second useful effect of these microbes is making bread. The fungus, there is one fungus which is called yeast. It is in the reproduces in flour dough, and it can be for the making of dosas, for idlis, for bread, for cakes, for biscuits, for pastries, all confectionery items. And when this yeast is inside the flour dough, it produces carbon dioxide during respiration, and this carbon dioxide makes the dough fluffy. Now, what are the commercial uses of microorganisms? Microorganisms are used for a large scale production of alcohol, that is fermented when the sugar is converted into alcohol. That process is called fermentation, and that fermentation happens because of the incomplete oxidation in the presence of yeast, that is a microorganism. Wine and acetic acid is also produced on large scale by microorganism. Yeast is used for commercial production of alcohol and wine. For this purpose, yeast is grown on natural sugars present in grains like barley, wheat, rice, the crushed fruit juices, the grape juices. And the process of conversion of these fruit sugars and the grain sugars into the alcohol is called fermentation. And Louis Pasteur was the biologist who discovered fermentation in 1857. Now, the microorganisms are helping us in medical field also. There is a medicinal use of microorganisms as well, because they are helping us. They are, the human beings are making antibiotics with the help of these microorganisms. Now, what are antibiotics? As the name suggests, anti means against, and biotics means life, against the life. So there are certain microorganisms which are helping in killing of other microorganisms. So they are called antibiotics. So when we are infected with a certain kind of microorganism, the antibiotics which are formed from the other microorganisms, they can have the effect of killing that microorganism which has produced the infection in our body. So that is why we take antibiotics. So whenever we fall ill, the doctor prescribes us some antibiotic tablets or capsules or injections like streptomycin, tetracycline, erythromycin, penicillin, And the sources of these antibiotic medicines are microorganisms. And these medicines are called antibiotics. These days, a number of antibiotics are being produced from bacteria and fungi. And these medicines, well, they are antibiotics because they kill or stop the growth of the disease-causing microorganism. But we have to take care. We have to be very, very careful while taking these antibiotics. Because when we are taking antibiotics, we know that these antibiotics are going to kill the microorganism which has caused the infection. But at the same time, these antibiotics might as well kill the friendly bacteria also, which are present in our body. So we have to be careful. We have to be taking, using these antibiotics only on the advice of a qualified doctor. It's not that we have cough and we'll go and buy some antibiotics and start taking it. No. Whenever we are taking antibiotics, we have to be taking these antibiotics only on the advice of a qualified doctor. And also another important thing which we should take care of is that we should finish the course. Because some the doctor will give you antibiotics for 5 days course or 3 days course. So you have to complete the course. Even if you have got well, if you think that now I am not suffering from the infection or not, now I am not having the fever, you should not stop taking the antibiotic, because you have to complete the course of that antibiotic, 5 days or 3 days, whatever it is. If you take antibiotics when not needed or in wrong doses, it may make the drug less effective when you might need it in future. Because in future, when suppose you are suffering from the same infection in future as well, or similar kind of infection, that time it will be less effective if you have not completed your dose, or if you have taken in the wrong dose, or if you have taken when it was not needed. So antibiotics should not be taken unnecessarily, because they will kill the beneficial bacteria also in our body. Antibiotics, however, are not effective against cold and flu, because cold and flu are caused by viruses, and that's why the antibiotics will not work on viruses. Similarly, for these days, when corona time also, for corona also, these antibiotics will not work. Now, penicillin was the antibiotic which was discovered by accident when the Alexander Fleming was working on some disease-causing bacteria. So he was culturing that bacteria in his laboratory, and to his utter surprise, he saw that his bacteria were not growing. And when he found out the reason, he concluded that there are some spores of a little green mold in his culture plate of bacteria. And because of the presence of that mold, the bacteria was not able to grow. And the bacteria were killed by this mold, this green colored mold. So, and this mold, he found afterwards that this mold was a fungus penicillin. So this is how the penicillin antibiotic was discovered, and this was by Alexander Fleming. Now, what is vaccine? We all take vaccine whenever a new child is born in our family, we take that child for vaccination to help us to prevent, to protect us from various diseases. Now we are waiting for vaccine of corona so that we can have that vaccine and we will be protected from this corona. But what exactly is vaccine? So vaccine is the inactive or the dead microbes of the same infection which is put inside our body. So whenever there is foreign body in our body, whenever there is a microbe in our body, our body's army becomes active. And what is our body's army? Our body's army is WBC. So these WBCs, they start making their army against that foreign invader. And that army is called antibodies. So antibodies are produced in our body whenever there is microbe in our body. So these antibodies are the army. They will fight with that germ and they will kill that germ, and we will be recovered from that illness. So what happens in vaccine? In vaccine, these dead or inactive form of those microbes are given to our body, which are not able to produce the infection because they are not active. But at the same time, they are able to produce the antibodies in our body. And our antibodies are ready for that germ. And our antibodies have the memory. So they recognize, yes, this is the microbe. And in future, whenever in our life, in future, if the same microbe is attacking us, the active microbe, then our army is ready to fight against it. So this is how a vaccine works. When a disease-carrying microbe enters our body, the body produces antibodies to fight the invader, that is the foreign invader, the foreign particle. The body also remembers how to feed the microbe if it enters again, because it has a memory. So if dead or weakened microbes are introduced in a healthy body, the body fights and kills them by producing suitable antibodies. So the antibodies remain in the body and we are protected from the disease-causing microbes. This is how a vaccine works. Several diseases, including cholera, tuberculosis, smallpox, we have completely overcome this smallpox with the help of the vaccine. Hepatitis, these can be prevented by vaccination. So children are given injections to protect themselves against several diseases. And these vaccines can be given in the oral form, like polio. Polio drops are there. For polio, the drops are there. Or in the injection. Necessary vaccines are available in the hospital. And there is an immunization program in India, and that immunization program, whenever a child is born, the government clinics, the healthcare centers, the hospitals, they make sure that the child has taken all the vaccines on time so that the child will be protected from all these diseases in future. Vaccinations are given to children for protection against polio under Pulse Polio program. You must be knowing that the people come, the health workers come door to door, and they ask whether the family is having a small child from 2 to 7 year old, and they give the polio drops, because you need a booster dose also for polio drops. So this is given, and this is a oral vaccination. Polio drops are oral vaccination. These days, vaccines are produced on a large scale to protect human and other animals from several diseases. We are waiting for the vaccine of for coronavirus as well. So hopefully in a short period of time, by early next year, we will be having vaccine for corona. Microorganisms are having a role in increasing soil fertility as well, because there are many free living and living in symbiosis with the roots of some plants. These microorganisms are present in the soil and they are fixing nitrogen. What do you mean by fixing of nitrogen? The nitrogen is getting converted into the nitrogenous compounds, in which the compounds which are consumable or which can be used by the plants. So these bacteria and blue-green algae, they fix the nitrogen from the atmosphere and they enrich the soil with nitrogen. And that by increasing the nitrogen of the soil, they are increasing the fertility of the soil. And microbes are commonly called biological nitrogen fixer, because they are living, they are organisms, and they are fixing nitrogen for the plant. So they are called biological nitrogen fixer. And this process of conversion of atmospheric nitrogen into usable nitrogenous compounds is called nitrogen fixation. So the most important job, as I told you, cleaning the environment. These organisms are acting as decomposers. They are converting the dead and decayed organic matter into reusable inorganic form, and this is how they are cleaning our environment. You must have often seen large amounts of dead organic matter in the form of decaying plants and sometimes dead animals on the ground, and you must be wondering that after a few days, after some time, they disappear. Now, where do they go? This is because the microorganisms decompose them, this dead organic waste of plants and animals, and convert them into simple inorganic substances which can be reused by the plants and animals. Those recycling is done of these minerals in the environment with the help of these microorganisms. So these substances are again used by other plants and animals, and thus microorganisms can be used to degrade the harmful and smelly substance. Otherwise, this world would be stinking, you know. We cannot survive in this world because of the microorganisms only. Because of the cleaning up of the environment, we are able to survive. And thereby, they clean up our environment and they convert the smelly, harmful substance into usable forms. And this is called biodegradation. So that's why we have divided our waste into biodegradable and non-biodegradable. The two types of waste are based on the this only, that whether they can be decomposed by the bacteria or the living organism or not. So these were the useful effects of microorganisms which we have learned in this part of our video. And in next part, we are going to learn about the harmful effects of microorganisms.